Alright, so we've got a few little programs we're going to use. One of them is for just gathering the scan data, and it's fairly powerful. You can do some post-processing. We tend to just grab the data and take it into a more powerful program. We can go down quite a bit. What this is going to do is kind of map the surface in little triangles. We're going to say that those triangles are going to be 0.5. So just imagine an equilateral triangle. It's going to try and map 0.5 millimeter long triangles over the surface.
What's the program you're running, Brian?
This is VX Elements. VX Elements. And it comes with the scanner. So, got it set up. It should be pretty good. At any given time, we want to be able to see at least three dots so the scanner kind of knows where it is.
So the dots are just talking to your scanners. Yep. What's happening?
So as I just kind of come, it gathers up the overall position. You saw some go blue for a moment or two. They didn't know where they were relative to the rest of the dots. And then it kind of figures out where they are. All right, so our target count, we've got 65 of them. So it's probably seen pretty much all of them. I think 60 or so was how many we had on there initially. See, we've already got some scan data coming in. So now we'll kind of slow down a little bit and actually spend some time scanning.
So it's starting to build the part digitally?
Yeah. So the little indicator on the left is just how far the scanner is. There isn't kind of an ideal distance. But the part does kind of rise above our surface, so it can kind of bounce really quickly. Definitely a good project for this because there are a lot of little measurements once we started taking the scan data and creating the sketch to actually build up the geometry. I'm glad I didn't have to measure it all. So some of the fun things it does is, it, notice as I move the scanner, it rotates everything else so it knows where it is relative to all those dots. You saw from our test one there that we're just kind of going for the outer profile. We're not too worried about the inner one. Just trying to get around all the outer edges. It does go quite a bit faster. But
so what these guys have done is they fit our Olympic bobsledders to their sleds. For the same process. And again, all I needed for our purposes was that top surface.
Right.
Just the contours on the top so we could build a plate for it.
What I really like is that you can actually stop pretty much any time. Zoom in, have a look at what you got. So what I'm going to be doing is creating a plane off of this surface, dropping it about a millimeter, and then using that plane, I can tell it to just trace what's there for me. And then we can draw on that. Pretty good. A little bit of missing data there, a little bit over there. But all in all, yeah, let's put that back edge. We can do some fun stuff, like we can lock the zoom and lock the viewpoint. I know that I want to run this edge.
And then everything else kind of stays still instead of following the scanner like we were. Get a little better idea of what it's doing with the laser. It's just mapping how it forms across the surface.
So, and just for fun, this scanner actually has a high resolution mode. I think it goes down to a thou. So I can go into a high resolution, and what you'll see in the same area here is my crosshairs are significantly smaller. And it's now kind of scanning it. Resolution. I like to just take all the raw data. Don't worry about messing with it. And you will see that there's, we zoom in here, the high resolution area.
Cool.
It starts to get a little bit more detail on what's going on, and you're going to see bumps in the surface because it does go to that high level.
Cool.
Over there. So one of the challenges is when it comes in, you see my planes, they're kind of up in the space. 000 is where I pull that trigger the first time, where it kind of figures where things are. So I don't really have a plane on that surface, so that's kind of where we'll start. I'm trying to make it so we can see our mesh a little better. So they do have some fairly nice tools. Can grab, you know, a little bit of that flat, a little bit of that one, a little bit of this one. Now I'll define a plane on that surface relative to those faces. Just kind of pick a few pieces of it. If I turn on the lines, you can start to see what the scanner actually built up as it was mapping the surface. We got those nice little 0.5 millimeter triangles. If we go over and look at that high resolution area, find an area where it transitions. So there's high resolution, there's 0.5 millimeter. So it's about 10 times the density, so you can get some really, really accurate stuff if you need it. We're even seeing the curve as it goes around that edge.
Keep in mind that this is a casting.
Beautiful little casting. So let's clean up our views a little bit. We'll take off the other planes. So I want a sketch of that outer profile. I'm just going to grab this plane. Just drag it down a little bit. It went down 19 millimeters. We'll adjust that. We'll go to negative 1. And all that's really doing for us is creating a plane that interferes all the way around. Yes, it's got draft because it's casting, but the amount of draft it has isn't going to kill us. So now that I have a plane interfering with the overall model, we can do what's known as a mesh sketch. And it goes and traces all of that for me.
So there's our tool path.
I'll just say okay. We've got all sorts of cool features. I can silhouette up and down. So if I was missing a little bit of data, I could say, well, look a couple millimeters above and a couple millimeters below of this and generate that sketch as well. You end up with a lot more data lines on it. This one's nice and clean. And then it's kind of a simple matter of going around and sketching. There are some auto sketch tools in here that'll try and map lines as best as it can. They can be a little frustrating. Sometimes it's easiest to just, you know, sketch point to point, put in your arcs, put in nominal diameters, because then you learn what the sizes actually are. But because it's done the mesh sketch, I can come in here, pick an arc, and it's going to map a circle to it. Say okay to that, and grab maybe my smart dimension tool and just see what it is. 4.9975. Odds are it's supposed to be a 5 millimeter hole. So it was looking at that hole for me taking the scanner and kind of bending it around and it's on an angle. And we did add a tiny bit of thickness by adding the powder in there. See, once you've done the scan, it's fairly easy to map these guys in. 6x205 and more. So I could go through the whole process of kind of sketching this up. That's painful. So I'm going to load up the other one that I did. That guy. Alright, so we got our mesh. We got that other plane in there. We got the sketch. It's kind of fully done. We just went all the way around, mapped it out. And then I created the extrude. Just like you would in SOLIDWORKS or a CAM software, got a profile, extruded out with some distance. If I create a new mesh, I can then select my part and just kind of copy it. I can then figure out, you know, what's my maximum chord height or length. So the quality of those triangles is going to use to map this surface. Say okay. And I'll say okay there. And it's now created a new mesh. So if I hide my solid body, and I hide the original scan, rid of our sketch as well, we're left with a triangle mapped surface. That's the new STL. So then we can take this guy and we'll export it. So So I got mesh 2 STL. Sounds good. Off to our rapid prototype program or your CAM software. Slices. Where's mesh 2? Just drag it in. Determine the unit. So it comes in and it's a, you know, it's at a bit of an arbitrary angle. Define its position. I'll just say, hey, that's the top surface. It lays it flat for us. Do a bit of basic machine setup. Knows what type I have. Knows what material I'm running. We're actually running white material these days. And then there's our slice height. So we can go as small as 5,000 slice layers. You saw this guy, you'll notice it is layered. There are 10,000 layers. We can go as high as 5 and as thick as 13,000. When you go really small and it's putting them out, it doesn't laminate them quite as nicely because they tend to cure really quickly, so the following layers don't adhere quite as nicely. With nice big thick layers, it takes longer for them to cool down, become inert again, so they stick quite nicely. We're running 10,000 right now. It's kind of a nice balance between speed and quality. And I'm just gonna tell it the process. Green flag is kind of dummy proof a little bit. So what it does, first of all, it goes, okay, every 10,000, I'm going to cut a layer. And if you see, we got 37 layers total. I'm going to go to the very bottom. And what we have is, it builds up a couple of support layers. That's what this guy is here. To kind of make sure it's got a true flat surface. It's got a platen in there and a plastic sheet that sucks down to it. And as we work our way up, built a nice perfect flat, that's what this surface is. Cross direction, then we get into the model. So there's the first part of the model. And what we don't see so much is actually a support layer. It would be made out of this other material that is water soluble. And then we can just go up through the part and it just alternates the layer direction. So this one not particularly interesting, that's the top layer, it finishes it off. 54 minutes. Brings up our control software for that machine and it's kind of go. And it'll go into that machine and it'll just build those layers one after another. And that's kind of the whole process. Get to the limit of things, or if you have really thin one, right? There are like finishing, or you know, there is a bit of finishing work to do. So as it does the round pass, you can see where it starts and finishes every path on that one. We just take a little bit of sandpaper generally, file it off. So that's fairly nice to just kind of do the finishing stuff.
Can you add to a modeling board you make?
So this just prints the part. What are those ones that print in powder?
They'll do the same thing, essentially. Yeah, they start with a thin layer of powder.
If it had been an accident or have been partially reconstructed, they were going to take out a chunk and replace it with a plate or a polymer or what have you. So we would print off these skulls, and what they had the opportunity to do was take a one-to-one model of this guy's skull, the bone thickness, everything else, do the cuts on the model, build the plate to fit that model before this guy's even gone under the knife or anything. So they would have stuff that fits perfectly. And the biggest thing that kind of helped with was they didn't have to leave their skulls open for so long. They weren't doing modifications while the guy was under anesthetic and under surgery. So they had stuff that would just drop in and go. And then, it fits. So my fancy dancy alignment tool. One of the reasons we went with this system, there are a number of other ones. There's UV cured polyjet systems. There's